Hey, brothers and sisters, this is your most favorite, your right favorite brother from another mother. And you know, over there in Europe, in England, they say, you know, right brother. So I'm your right brother from another mother. Hope you guys are doing all right today. May the grace of God be with you, brothers and sisters. I tried to make a video earlier today, and I had to just go back and think about it a little bit, meditate on it, come back again, brothers and sisters. Because, you know, brothers and sisters, there's just so much nonsense on YouTube. You know, it's like, where do you begin, you know? It's like throwing a rock, you know, trying to take stones and knock down the Great Wall of China. It's just so much nonsense, brothers and sisters, on YouTube. Praise God, brothers and sisters. Praise God for His Spirit of truth, Lord, that the Lord gave us. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I just wanted to say too that it was a huge blessing we had. Huge, awesome time of fellowship down in Charlotte in NASCAR country there, where I met with the brothers and sisters down there just near the Richard Petty driving experience NASCAR museum. You know, they used to have those jokes, you might be a redneck jokes. Jeff Foxworthy used to do. So, you know, if you're from a place that's famous for racing and wrestling and barbecue and all that stuff, you might be a redneck. You know, that's the expression. But anyway, brothers and sisters, we had a great time with the Lord. We were able to have seven people baptized, so praise God for that. Praise God for that. I wanted to have more time to pray with people. I mean, that's the downside of meeting with all a group at the same time. It's hard to get to talk to everybody and pray with everybody. And I've asked, pray, you know, communicate with those brothers and sisters now, having met them more effectively. But, you know, I pray by the grace of God that, you know, I'll be able to see them all again. If not now, and when we get up to heaven. And I asked you guys again, I mentioned it in last video, to pray for Sister Shalia. She's a young woman she's on a college scholarship for athletic scholarship, but she has financial needs for her housing, and I just prayed with her in agreement that the Lord would make a way. Asked you to pray for this young sister. If anybody wants to get in contact with her, you can email me and I will connect you with her, you know, for prayer and whatnot, and advice that or something that the Lord may share with you for her. Please let me know. And I'll be glad to connect you with her, Sister Shalia. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I ask you to pray for that. And anyway, I also ask you to pray for the coming up trip. We'll be going to Chicago, July 22nd through 25th, and then Minneapolis. From the afternoon of the 25th, we'll be doing baptisms up there on Sunday, July 26th, at a place called White Bear Lake. In Chicago, will be in Naperville. On the 23rd, whatever it is, 23rd and 24th, in the morning of the 25th, be meeting people and baptizing. Anyway, brothers and sisters, praise God, praise God, praise God. I just wanted to come on here and encourage you guys. There is a rapture. There is a rapture, brothers and sisters. God has an escape from this earth. Jesus Christ used that word. You know, these people, they use all kinds of logical thinking or whatever, false logic, that there is no rapture. And it doesn't matter what any man-made ideas or logic is, brothers and sisters. All number one is the Word of God. The Word of God clearly lays out a pre-tribulation rapture. Just as I will use the word escape, they say, oh, you think, you know, you want to escape. Jesus said, Luke 21:36, talking about the tribulation, He said, watch therefore and pray always that you might escape these things that are going to happen. The tribulation, that's just what He's been talking about. Luke chapter 21, escape these things and stand before the Son of Man. That you may be kind of worthy to escape these things and stand from the Son of Man. So I can give you two sides of the same coin here. There are people who believe they said a sinner's prayer when they're 10 years old. They've lived like the devil all their life and they think they're going to be raptured. That one Bible verse from Jesus addresses that issue also. The fact that what I call greasy grace, this false grace, it's not the grace of God, but a false grace, doing what I just said. You can live like hell and go to heaven without repentance. Just believe and make a mental assent that Jesus Christ is Lord without confessing your sins, without repenting. Repenting means to change your mind and then to change your ways. Change your mind and change your ways. You know, one is the Greek meaning and then the Hebrew meaning. One is a change of mind and one is a change of ways. Both is what we need to do. When we repent, we change our mind. Hey, we know what we're doing is wrong. Then repent, we turn from that. We are in a process of turning from our sin. We're in the process of quitting smoking. We're in the process of quitting drinking. You know, whether it be one day or one week or one month or whatever. God is delivering us from our sins. As fast as our faith will come in agreement with the Word of God. Anyway, the reverse of that coin is the what I'm focusing on by the grace of God in this video is the other extreme. People that believe that we have to go through the tribulation to be purified. But you know what? There are people who are not truly born again today who do need to be purified. The focus of the tribulation is for, number one, it is called the time of Jacob's trouble. The time of Jacob's trouble, the 70th week of Daniel. The time of Yahweh's strange work. The great and terrible day of the Lord. All these things. That's another thing with these misinformed non pastors, you know, say, oh, it's the day of the Lord. Well, the day of the Lord is not a single day in human days. It is the time period we call the return of Christ, that process in the millennial reign of Christ. It's a seven-year tribulation, which is the birth pains and the process of the return of Jesus Christ to rule and reign on earth. And then the thousand-year reign of Christ on earth. That is the day of the Lord. So right now we're living in the day of grace, the day of the church age, the year of Jubilee. You know, so that's why we have to be all about that grace, no devil. All about that grace, brothers and sisters, all the time. It's all about grace. So, there is a pre-tribulation rapture. The Lord has promised us that. Revelation 3:10, Jesus speaking to the church of Philadelphia. One of the seven churches, he said, because you have patiently kept my word, or you have kept the word of my patience, I will keep you out of the hour of temptation that will come upon the whole earth to try all those that dwell on the earth. So the Lord has made promises. And if we're kind of worthy, we will escape. Now that leads us to Matthew chapter 25. The parable of the wise and the foolish virgins, brothers and sisters. So maybe it's this, you know, this is a theory. Those people who are appointed to be left here during the tribulation, well, maybe that's why they don't believe in the rapture, because they're going to be here. They, you know, they're going to be here because of this. Probably because all that sin of self-righteousness they have. You know, I saw a brother making a comment on a video, which I don't watch many videos. Just last night, the Lord led me to watch a video by Chuck Messler discussing about the rapture. And then I had a sister emailing me about the rapture and asking me about, you know, people who are mocking the rapture, who are like Paul said, you know, these people that think they're somebody, who are somebodies in this world, mocking the rapture, mocking the wedding dress of the bride, and all this demonic spew that is not from God, but filth and excrement from the enemy, mocking the things of God, calling themselves in the ministry. And I saw this brother, he wrote, you know, the problem with post-tribbers is they are venomously, demonically, you know, not from God, he said, you know, not from God, attacking people that believe in the pre-tribulation rapture as laid out in the Bible, instead of going after non-believers and Buddhists and Hindus and Muslims and all those things. They have a vehement, vitriolic, self-righteous, arrogant Phariseeism about attacking pre-tribbers. Now, you don't see pre-tribbers doing that. So, brothers and sisters, this is a clue that people who are pre-trib, just in the spiritual and the fruit of it, are kind of on to something. And the people that are post-tribbers are very bitter, full of gall and bitterness. Now, if I thought that I had to earn my salvation, I guess I would be a Pharisee. I guess I would be full of gall and bitterness. Because they seem to think that they're going to earn their salvation by going through the tribulation. So the downside of that is that wouldn't be fair. What about all the people that live from the time of Christ until now? They didn't, who's died already. They didn't experience the tribulation, so therefore they didn't have that opportunity to purify themselves through their own works and their own deeds. So that's not really fair. You know, it's just so simple, brothers and sisters. I could run through a list of 100 reasons. I don't know about 100. I sound like Donald Trump now. You know, there's a lot of reasons. I just don't want to get off topic, but I just want to say Donald Trump is the only one in the natural, in the flesh, Donald Trump is the only one saying that will save America. It's to renegotiate all these free trade deals and save our culture and our border and our language and our business. But I don't want to get into that. We know that's for the world. But anyway, brothers and sisters, as I just mentioned, there's lots of things. I could just go through a list, and I've made so many videos. Let's just run over a few. There's 144,000 Israeli witnesses. That's another thing, too. There are all these people who are Gentile. As a matter of fact, it's also silly that lots of them are women who believe that the 144,000 witnesses are somehow, you know, it's a metaphoric thing, you know, and they're members of the church, and then it's not really Israel. So you got replacement theology going on, which is, you know, denying the Old Testament, throwing it away technically. See, they don't even, people just want to have this, you know, they want to be somebody. They want to be somebody famous in the Bible. See, they don't look at the end result. So when you start saying, well, if this is what you believe, then A, B, and C must be true. See, they don't even think about that things. They're way over there on the shallow end of the pool. They're not even thinking of the consequences of these doctrines they're trying to come up with. The rapture is a literal event. As an example, the Jehovah Witnesses, you know, they already have this. You know, you guys are just copying the Jehovah Witnesses. Because they take the number 144,000 to be literal. But in the same sentence, the Holy Spirit of God switched up and went from literal 144,000, but 12,000 from this tribe and 12,000 from this tribe. That part's not literal. It's just literally 144,000. And then he was metaphorically naming the tribes and metaphorically saying they're males. That was all metaphoric. Now, the only word in there that could possibly be metaphoric, possibly, is the word virgin, or meaning, you know, unspotted from the world versus, you know, literally, in the flesh, virgin, even though it could mean that too. You know, that is the only word in there that's kind of like, you know, open to question. You know, what does it mean by virgin? Does it mean they're not married? Does it, you know, and single, which is also the way the word virgin is used sometimes in the Bible. It can mean someone that's unmarried, and then it can mean someone who is, you know, in those days, it's assumed if you're not married, then you haven't had relations. See, so it's kind of hand in hand. Or does it mean that they're virgins to, you know, false religion, you know, and all this kind of thing? So are all of those things, brothers and sisters, all of those things. See, but the 144,000 is literal, and from the 12 tribes is literal, and that they are male is literal. Very, there's, you know, that's exactly what it means. All in the same sentence. Okay, so that being said, see, that's a whole nother point to deal with all of the false doctrine and wacky nonsense on YouTube. Like I say, it's like wading through a cesspool here. Now, God give me the grace to do this. Now, why do we need 144,000 witnesses doing God's will around the world if the church is still here? Of course, we don't. That is the time of Jacob's trouble. It's the time God is dealing with Israel. There will be many Gentiles who will be saved during the tribulation by the work of those 144,000 and all that. They'll be sealed by God and sent out to replace the church, because the church will be gone, brothers and sisters. It's the end of the church age. At the second coming, the Lord returns to earth. He lands on the Mount of Olives, Zechariah 14. And the mountain splits in twain, and he walks through the Kidron Valley there, over there through the Eastern Gate, right up there to the Temple Mount. Every eye shall see him, and every tribe will mourn, tells us in Revelation chapter 1, all these things. But the rapture, he comes as a thief in the night. No man knows the day or the hour. The second coming, when the tribulation begins, we could calculate. Listen to me, because these people who are spouting, they don't even know how to do math, and they don't even know the calculations. It's written right in the Bible. Brothers and sisters, the Bible interprets itself. The Bible gives us sets of dates, of days, 1,260 days for part one, and then I think it's and then there's an extra 60 days on the second half because it's a cleansing of the temple and all this other stuff. You know, 1,300 and some odd days, because that includes the cleansing of the temple after the return of the Messiah. But it's 3.5 years, a biblical prophetic year is 360 days, not 365. So there's 3.5 years, the first half of the tribulation, and then there's 3.5 years of what we call the Great Tribulation, the second half. And I've done videos on this. I don't know how far I'll go with this. I'm running 15 minutes. But so there's a set time. There is 7-year period design. So when the tribulation begins, now when does the tribulation begin? It begins when the Antichrist, Daniel 9:27, when the Antichrist confirms a covenant with many for a period of 1:7, which is 7 years right there. Daniel 9:27. Then we got the days laid out there in the book of Revelation for 2 sets of 3.5. Now, because it also tells us in Daniel in that same verse, 9:27, in the middle of the week, he will break the covenant. Now, see, you have to take Daniel and Revelation together. So what happens in the middle of the 7 years? It tells us in Revelation, after that first 1,260 days, the Antichrist will go to the Temple Mount. He will kill the two witnesses. See, the amount of days that the witnesses will preach is written in the Bible. The amount of days that they will offer sacrifices in the temple they will build as part of that 7-year covenant, there's an amount of time that they will offer sacrifices. Now, if you can calculate that, you can see that when the tribulation begins, there's also another group of people who think that, oh, well, we can't have the tribulation because the temple hasn't been rebuilt. But if you do a simple reading of the Word of God and a little bit of math, you don't have to have no algebra, if you can use a calculator if you have to, you will see that it gives the exact amount of days they will offer sacrifices in the new temple up there on the Temple Mount, the nation of Israel, as part of their agreement with the Antichrist. And the sacrifice will be cut off at the mid-trib at 3.5 years. In the middle of the week, he will break the covenant. He will go into the temple and declare himself that he is God. 2 Thessalonians 2. He will say he's God. He will do the abomination that causes desolation, standing in the holy place. And that's when Jesus talks about the Israelites fleeing to the mountaintops and fleeing from the city at that time because destruction's coming. They will flee to Petra. This is mid-trib. Not all this wacky, upside-down pyramid nonsense, because a non-believer is not a holy place who takes the mark. And people that are half fallen angel and half man are not a holy place. So all of that nonsense that you've heard from demonic spirits speaking through people on YouTube is not biblical at all. Anyhow, there's just so many directions, brothers and sisters. I'll just plug through with what I can follow here in one video. So, mid-trib. So that they will offer sacrifices at the temple for about 2.5 years. The exact amount of days, that's not in the top of my head. But if you calculate it, you'll see there's about a year from the signing of the peace treaty until they start the sacrifices. So we can say that it takes them about a year to build that temple. And they've got it prefabbed already. As a matter of fact, they've already prefabbed it and they've set it up out there at the Dead Sea. Then they took it back apart. They've got everything ready. As soon as they get to go, they can go up there and set it up in a year, no problem, and get ready to offer sacrifices. And then we know the exact amount of time, which is from the after 1 year to mid-trib. And then the Antichrist will cease the offerings. He will go in there, declare himself to be God. He'll offer, the abomination that causes desolation. We have a type of that, of something that happened in the past. I think it's about 146 or 164 B.C. We have, which I mentioned this many times before, Epiphanes IV. You know, he went in there. Antipas Epiphanes IV went in there and sacrificed a pig and set up an altar to Zeus and all this stuff. And that's what the Antichrist is going to do. That same thing referred to in Daniel, and then Jesus quoted from it, the abomination causes desolation, standing in the holy place. Flee from here. Don't go back to your house to get your stuff. Take off. He's talking to Israel. They will go to Petra. The church will be in heaven. Israel will go to Petra and hide. The Antichrist will rule, will reign havoc. He will kill the two witnesses. As I said, there's an exact amount of days that the two witnesses will prophesy. He will kill them. So if you calculate that, you'll see that they start prophesying basically at the beginning of the tribulation. So if we want to know that the tribulation has started with that 7-year covenant with many, you'll hear, oh, they made a deal for Israel to rebuild the temple. Oh, they divided the land, like it tells us in Joel chapter 2 and chapter 3. Part of the deal will be to divide the land. And then the two witnesses will appear there near the Wailing Wall. It'll be Enoch and Elijah, or Moses and Elijah as the, you know, disagreement that people have over exactly who they are. And they both have different reasons why they say that. I mean, Moses and Elijah appear to Jesus at the Mount of Transfiguration, but the Bible says it's appointed that a man wants to die and then the judgment. So Enoch and Elijah are the only two that didn't die. And, you know, so that's a debate that people have. Who cares? You know, whatever. When it happens, we'll say, oh, there it is. Okay, well, you're right. Ooh, you were right. You win a cookie. You know, but brothers and sisters, we won't be here. Praise God. The church will be gone. All this is that you might know that Jesus Christ is Lord. That people might know that he's in charge of everything going on here. And as I made a video a couple years ago, it said Jesus is not a wife beater. Jesus is not a wife beater. He's not going to beat his bride. And that's exactly what these old demonic spew people, self-appointed, they're not even preachers, on here spewing all these lies and mocking the things of God. Brothers and sisters, I'll tell you right now, we have the victory in Christ. We, those five wise virgins, we are the bride of Christ. Those who will be called up to meet the Lord, we are the bride of Christ. God is the Lord is never going to marry a city. It said that Jerusalem, New Jerusalem, comes down like a bride, as like a bride in the text. It's metaphoric, ordained, you know, it's decked, you know, in ornaments. That's why Jerusalem looks like a bride, because it's so beautiful and it's, you know, all decked out. You know, when a bride gets married, she's got all these, you know, earrings, whatever, and bracelets and a beautiful dress and all those things, whatever. That's what it's referring to. Very simple, plain in the text. Jesus is not going to marry a city. And as we see, when you ever been to a wedding ceremony, you will see how in Ephesians we see Paul saying that, you know, it's a great mystery about Christ and the church. You know, that Jesus is the head of the church and all that. And there's like a husband and a wife and all those things. Adam and Eve is type and shadow of Christ and his church, Christ and his bride. That's why we're called the body of Christ. When two get married, they become one flesh. They become one flesh. All of these things in the Old Testament, even marriage, brothers and sisters, Adam and Eve, are that you might know that Jesus Christ is the head of the church. God created that whole system. The whole system of marriage and all that, the ultimate thing with everything God does on earth is to bring glory to himself. All these patterns and shadows in creation lead to one thing, that Jesus Christ is Lord. Hallelujah. That's what it all goes to, brothers and sisters. It all boils down to that. Now, these people that want to be tormented and they want to get their head chopped off, let them go for it. Let them go for it. Maybe God put that in their heart because they are going to be left behind because of their arrogance and self-righteousness. I don't know. Brothers and sisters, by the grace of God, I pray, as Jesus said, pray always that you be counted worthy to escape the tribulation and stand before him. Now, brothers and sisters, God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. So I beseech thee at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, brother and sister, that you not be in fear and trembling, but be in faith. God, without faith, it's impossible to please God, and he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Hebrews 11:7. God gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud, the Bible says, brothers and sisters. He has a home in heaven for us. What did the Lord tell us? John 14, another proof text of the rapture. With the second coming, the Lord returns to earth. He's going to judge the goats and the sheep. Those people on earth, if the catching up, a lot of these people think he'll catch the church up in the air and then they'll just turn right back around and land on earth with us again. And then he's going to judge and separate the goats from the sheep. Well, if we just got caught up with him 5 minutes ago and landed right back on earth, why would we need to be told that we're sheep? We'd already know it because we'd just got our glorified bodies. We hadn't had time to do anything else. And the people that were left behind, of course, they're goats because they got left behind. They don't need to be told that. They already know it because the judgment was as they were left behind. They wouldn't even have time to react or repent about it. Totally, totally simplest common sense you ever thought of, brothers and sisters. When Jesus comes for his church, he comes as a thief in the night. And just like that, the parable of the 10 virgins, the midnight hour, the call rang out, behold, the bridegroom cometh. The second coming, every eye shall see him. And every tribe will mourn because of him. Revelation 1. He'll return to this earth and everyone will see him. He will destroy at his return, he will destroy the Antichrist and the false prophet with the brightness of his appearing and the word of his mouth. You know, the sword coming out of his mouth. The word of God. He will destroy the enemy. Just like in the beginning, he said, let there be life. At the end, he'll say, let there be death to the Antichrist and the false prophet and all those things. He will destroy those who are trying to destroy the earth, it says. At the rapture, he comes as a thief in the night. He said in John chapter 14, in my Father's house are many mansions. I go to prepare a place for you. If it were not so, I would have told you. And I go to prepare a place for you, and then I will come and get you and receive you unto myself. We'll be with the Lord in heaven. How are we going to be with the Lord in heaven? He's back here on earth, ruling and reigning for 1,000 years. No, we'll be there with him during the tribulation. All those things we'll be doing, getting our judgment, getting our crowns, all those things. You know, the 24 elders are wearing their crowns when John gets up there. Revelation chapter 4, John is caught up to heaven, and then he sees the 24 elders already wearing crowns. The judgment's already taking place on the church. The judgment of the church for rewards has already happened. It's already happened at the time the seals are open, before the tribulation begins. You know, there's lots of people, too, coming from the Are You Serious crowd. You know, the people don't want to reveal what they really believe because they're not sure. They don't know what they're talking about, and they want to please everybody. But that crowd believes that the tribulation begins, or the rapture happens at the sixth seal. But when I read my Bible, the elders already are seated and wearing their crowns from the judgment seat of Christ, the bema seat of Christ, before any of the seals are open. So before any of the seals, which is the kickoff of the tribulation from heaven's view, that first seal with a rider on a white horse, with a bow and a crown and no arrows, that is the Antichrist going forth. That is the start of the tribulation, the first seal, brothers and sisters. And the church is already in heaven. The 24 elders are already seated wearing their crowns. The Lord has already had his judgment seat for the bride. It's already happened. Come on, brothers and sisters. It's just so simple. If you would read your Bible, just read your Bible and receive what it says. I mean, I'm just scratching the surface. I could go through hundreds of these and lay it out just in common sense, brothers and sisters. The problem is that people, they're not even saved. You know, they get on the internet and they said a prayer when they were 10 years old at the First Baptist Church of the Self-Righteous, and they're sitting on their blessed assurance and getting liquored up. And then one day they decide, oh, you know, I believe it's the end times. So I'm going to go back, get right with God. So they get on the internet, they read these things, they say, okay, I believe this, I believe that, I believe this, a little cafeteria Christianity. They get all these pieces, they copy and paste and go wild trolling on the internet. They don't even know what they're talking about. They don't even know where these doctrines come from. It's an ignorance of the word, brothers and sisters, in these last days. The ignorance of the simple reading of the word of God, brothers and sisters, which causes many to perish. People trying to follow the law, that whole group of Judaizers, a whole other group. It's sad, brothers and sisters. It is very sad. People won't humble themselves and sit down and shut up and read their Bible. You know, and I've said that many times. People need to sit down and shut up and humble themselves and read the Bible and pray and seek discernment and wisdom. Stop copying and pasting and running to and fro. All of this nonsense, brothers and sisters, people need to be still. And ask for discernment, brothers and sisters. I'm just scraping the surface of dividing the word for you here. It's all so simple, brothers and sisters. That's why Jesus said, in order to enter the kingdom of heaven, we must become as a little child. It's beyond simple, brothers and sisters. But man has made it complicated. See, what they do is they put on their doctrine-coated glasses. They put on their doctrine-coated glasses, and they say, this is my doctrine. There is no rapture. And they try to look at the Bible through that lens. They say, oh, once saved, always saved. They try to look at the Bible through that lens. Every scripture needs to bend and bow and be conformed to the image of God that I've made. Instead of saying, Lord, I don't know anything. Lord, I don't even know, the excrement from Shinola. You know, Lord, I don't know dung from Shinola. Can you, I only know what you would reveal to me, Lord. I'm a truth seeker. And brothers and sisters, those guys, of you guys who have been watching my videos for a long time, you know, I am a truth seeker. I start from scratch, from a clean slate. And I build my understanding and doctrine of the Word of God from the Word of God in prayer and study. And I listen to people, you know, who are maturing the faith. I will just say this. I don't know anybody besides me, hardly, that is a preacher on YouTube whose their ministry is on YouTube making videos. Almost 100% of all the other people are not ordained ministers, and I'm not saying people can't make videos. I'm talking about doctrinal statements. Don't get your doctrinal statements from people on YouTube, unless you know. There's this pastor Farik. I don't know if I'm pronouncing his name right, from Hawaii. I've never watched his videos. I hear lots of people saying good stuff about him. He's an ordained minister. Now maybe he's doing some good stuff. I don't know. But generally speaking, you need to go to tried and true, accepted preachers, and there's lots of, they have their videos are on YouTube, and they lay out lots of sound doctrines. But everybody's not perfect on every single doctrine, there's no doubt, brothers and sisters. But if you would read your word and pray, and then listen to the learned men of God who you trust, who you know as much as you can, and you know they know kind of what they're talking about, maybe they went to school or something, you know, kind of have an idea what they're talking about, and you take what they have to say, then you pray about that, and you research the word again, and you go back and forth and say, yeah, you know what, I think he's right, there is a rapture, you know, because he's explained it pretty good, and now I look at the scripture, yeah, I can see that. Instead of all this reactionary, shallow end of the pool, and then people wanting to debate and fight. Being a Christian is not about fighting and debating. I don't fight and debate people. These people on comments, people ask me questions, that's awesome. People get on there debating and all this. No. The Christian video is not a forum for strife and debate and argument and all that stuff. Oh, no, it's not. Not on my channel. You can make your own videos, whatever the Lord leads you to do, whatever you think the Lord's leading you to do, go for it. Put out what you think the Lord's teaching you and showing you. That's not a problem. People just do whatever you want to do, and that's the whole problem. People are doing whatever they want to do. Just like it says in Judges, everybody's doing what they think is right in their own eyes. And that's the problem in the Laodicean church age that we're living, the last days church. And like I said, I've said this several times, I want to say it again. Number one, if you don't know what's the last church in the book of Revelation, the Laodicean church, and you don't know that's the lukewarm church, then you probably shouldn't be making videos about the end time. End times. If you do not know that it's Revelation, not Revelations, you probably shouldn't be making videos about the end times. I should make a whole list. If you don't know what the word eschatology means, you should probably not be making videos about the end times, and you should not be spouting doctrines. That's what I'm talking about. It's a whole different thing when a brother or sister gets on and says, hey, I had a dream from the Lord, I had a vision from the Lord, this is what it was, and this is what I think it means. That's awesome. And I want to repeat that again to emphasize that. People on here trying to make doctrinal statements who are not ordained ministers. No go. No go, brothers and sisters. Beware of people making doctrinal statements who are not preachers. That's where all this nonsense is coming from. And like I said, I think of several times about naming names, but I don't. But like I said, don't get your doctrinal statements from truck drivers. And don't get your news from preachers, and you'll probably be doing all right. That's just a simple rule right there, brothers and sisters. Simple. Anyway, brothers and sisters, you know that I love you guys. You know that. And I appreciate all the people that have helped me with the orphanages and the feeding programs. And, you know, we got the 4 orphanages now. Praise God for that, brothers and sisters. And I'm going to go forward with whatever I can do for the Lord before the rapture happens. You know, going to Chicago, Minneapolis, baptizing people. After that, I just want to see on here people who are my... true brothers and sisters in Christ are probably still watching this video. We just found out that we're expecting our second child. And those of you who have been watching my videos, you know that I had, before I ever got married to my wife, I had a dream that we would have 2 children, a boy and then a girl, and even their names. The Lord gave me their names. So, you know, I mean, and there's people that, you know, base what about the rapture off of what anybody says. No. Even though I had a dream that this child would be a girl that would be 18 months old, doesn't mean that the rapture won't happen before this child is 18 months old. Doesn't mean that. But to me it does. Personally, to me it does. But not to, as a doctrinal thing, that there can't be any rapture to this baby. It's not even born yet, will be 18 months old, like 2 years from now. No. Don't base your life off of my life, of my personal thing here. But that's true. That's the dream that I had, and I believe it'll come to pass to myself. As I believe it. But I wouldn't, you know, I can't say that the rapture won't happen before that, because the Bible tells us, Jesus said, no man knows the day or the hour. Jesus said he'd come at a time we least expect. You know what? That midnight hour. So I would be wrong. I would be biblically wrong to say that he can't come until this baby's 18 months old. Do you see what I'm saying? And that's what people are doing. They're saying all these non-biblical things and false statements that can't be true. You can't say the date of the rapture. Now, sometimes, you know, if you say the Lord revealed it to you and then you get on here and say it, then, well, it doesn't happen, then, well, you didn't hear it from the Lord. So, you know, you're taking that chance. Anyway, brothers and sisters, you know, God bless you all. I ask for your prayers. I need your prayers, because it's going to be hard for me doing the traveling with the wife being pregnant, and then, you know, having another baby and all that, going back and forth to all these places. So ask for your prayers for that, brothers and sisters. And I just want to mention here on the end that, you know, I'm still have $30,000, which is a lot, I know, outstanding on the orphanage number 3. I know God will provide. And, like I said, I think all those people have helped with orphanages and the feeding programs and all that. And like I said, I will continue to go forward and do all that I can do until we're caught up to meet the Lord and occupy till He comes and not back off. To push through always, brothers and sisters. The Bible says, Jesus said, Matthew chapter 25, blessed is the servant. When the master comes, he finds his servants working. So let's get to work. Let's finish it up, brothers and sisters. God bless you. Love you all.